Hello, this is Herman Osterwijk, and we're doing an exam prep review of the CIIP exam. And the guide we're going to be using is the OTECH'S study guide that you might be familiar with. If not, you can find it on our website. It's not necessarily required to have this study guide, but it's kind of handy because it guides you for all the different topics that I'm going to talk about. Now, with regard to the CIIP exam, quite a few topics, and so what I did for this particular review is I picked on the ones that are maybe a little bit hard to understand, a little bit tricky, focusing on the connectivity, DICOM, IHE, and things like that. So, and some other things that I think, so I basically what I did, I went through the study guide and I highlighted the things that that I know very likely be on the exam test and might be a little bit tricky to understand. And in addition, we solicited a couple of questions from the audience that we can address as well. So the first thing I was going to talk a little bit about is the HIPAA. HIPAA is very important, deals with security and privacy. I'm talking about page 53 right now of the study guide. And so some of the key terms that you probably need to be familiar with is, of course, what is HIPAA, number one. And that's HIPAA is the regulation, federal regulation in the United States that deals with security and privacy. And there's a couple of terms that you probably should know, and that is, first of all, a covered entity, CE, covered entity. So the covered entity is a, like I said, is an entity, for example, hospital or physician, that is covered under the HIPAA regulation. And that's why, for example, anytime you go to see a physician, you first need to sign a HIPAA form because they are covered as an entity under the HIPAA regulation, and it tells you typically what are their rights, your rights, and what are their rights and commitments as well with regard to keeping it private and secure. So covered entity, CE, is a term you need to know. Then second will be business associates, BA. And that's actually a lot under discussion recently because a new extended regulations of the HIPAA regulation came out that actually told the business associates that they are actually also accountable for any potentially issues with divulging the proprietary and information. So business associates, BA, is an important term to know. And then PHI, because that's really what it's all about, personal health information, patient health information sometimes called. PHI is the information that needs to be kept private and secure. So HIPAA, we need to know what it is, some terms, PHI, covered entity, CE, and business associates. So another term that you need to know about is MQSA. MQSA is the Mammography Quality Standards Act, and basically it tells you what are the quality procedures that have to be implemented for running a mammography operation to be able to do this, the mammography exams. So this act tells very specifically that you need to, first of all, be accredited by the FDA accreditation body, certified by the FDA, undergo an annual inspection, and also display the accreditation as well. Now, an important component of the MQSA is the monitor calibration. So monitors need to be calibrated regularly for any diagnostic viewing anyway, but specifically for digital mammography, I know several centers that actually calibrate the monitors on a weekly basis, even although they're automatically calibrated. So that's an important component. So monitor calibration, essential component of MQSA. And let me talk a little bit about how this calibration works, and because that might come up as a question as well. The calibration calibrates the monitor according to GSDF, grayscale standard display function. Some people call it the DICOM curve, Barton curve. But a GSDF is the standard that is used to calibrate the monitors against. GSDF, another important term that you very likely need to know and might be asked for. Let me skip a little bit to learning objectives. This, as a healthcare IT professional, we deal a lot with learning and training. Many cases, the vendor will train the trainer, and there's a couple of principles, learning principles, that you should be familiar with, and that might be part of the test as well. Page 98 talks a little bit about learning objectives, and an important term to know is Bloom's taxonomy. What's Bloom's taxonomy? I'm going to read it here from the study guide. Remembering, understanding, then we do applying and analyzing, then we evaluate and create. So Bloom's taxonomy, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 components that you probably should be aware of. And then also dealing with the education and the learning objectives. Let me just look here. There's the process of learning, as explained more on page 101, deals with cognitive practice and knowledge. So that might be asked for as well. So let's jump straight into some of the connectivity issues. We know that we need to know, definitely will be asked about the DICOM standard. So when two devices communicate, there are actually two steps that take place. First of all, an association is negotiated. So association is nothing else than the DICOM connection. And the association is negotiated between two devices, and these are called application entities. So we negotiate these associations by proposing presentation contexts. Now, what is a presentation context? You can think about a presentation context as an item in a, what I call it, in a shopping list. So let's say a CT scanner wants to talk to the PACS and propose different presentation contexts. For example, they might say, I want to do CT images and I want to store them compressed, and also MRI images uncompressed, for example. So in the presentation context, there will be two components. Each presentation context has what you want to do and how to encode it. Now, the what you want to do is actually defined as a subclass. Now, what is a subclass? A subclass is a combination of a service and an object together, so a service-object pair. So a subclass, an example of that, will be a service being stored. And the object will be CT, so be storing CT images. That will be an example of a subclass. And later on, we'll talk about some special subclasses as key images and presentation states. But for now, remember, it's a service object pair. So let's go back up. An association is established by proposing various presentation contexts. The presentation context has two components, subclass and then the transfer syntax. The transfer syntax will tell you the encoding. One of the questions that came in actually via the emails was, can I have multiple transfer syntaxes when you do a DICOM association? The answer is sure, you can do transfer syntaxes. A good example would be if I have an ultrasound unit that wants to talk to the PACS. And the ultrasound unit might say, I want to exchange the cine loops, we call them ultrasound multiframe, and also the still frames, we call them ultrasound single frame. Both subclasses, multiframe and single frame, could be, for example, in two different presentation contexts, but will have different transfer syntaxes. For the, let's say, multiframe, I might do the JPEG, mossy compression, and then for the single frame, I might just do the uncompressed. So you can have multiple transfer syntaxes. So subclasses, transfer syntaxes, important things that you need to know about. And important terms, and also the whole association concept. Now, another thing that is negotiated is also the PDU size, protocol data unit, PDUs. So these are very often configured, and it might be, let's say, 1K, 5K, 10K. Sometimes they're defined in the back of a conformance statement. What are the configuration options? Now, let me talk a little bit about some of these special subclasses. A very special subclass is a key image object. We talk about it more about page 124 of your study guide, key image selection, and also talk a little bit about image annotation. So what is a key image selection? A key image selection works as follows. I might look at 600 images, and as a radiologist, I might say, well, 600 images is a little bit of an overkill to send them all to my referring physician. Because it might be 600 images and it has a lot of information that is not necessarily relevant for my diagnosis. There might be only 3 key images that are important for my physician to look at. So those key images can be annotated. I can put some text and say this is for surgery. And then those three images are identified with a key image object. Key image object, a separate special subclass. The subclass will be a storage, key image object storage, key image storage. And actually the modality we use that to identify will be KON, KON. So these are the key images. And then another special case will be the overlays or presentation state. Now DICOM has an other very special subclass that deals with the overlays or the annotations, but also with the grayscale manipulations such as flip, rotate, window width and level. So we do that with DICOM presentation state object. DICOM presentation state object has all the image manipulations as part of the body, so to speak. So if you think about an image, it has an image header and then the pixel data. For presentation state, it will be the same header, but then part of the body will be all the image manipulations. Special subclass. Now, there are also other ways to encode overlays. I can do it as a, what we call group 6000. This is really a bitmap as part of the DICOM header. Or I can put it even in the highlights of the high bits of the pixel data itself. So back up a little bit. We have regular subclasses, such as CT image storage. We have key objects, right, key images. And we have presentation states, all different subclasses that are negotiated, again, by defining them in their presentation context when I open an association. So to find out whether your PACS system or your receiver supports these, you need to look at the conformance statement and find out the subclass UIDs, whether these subclass UIDs of the presentation states and the key images are supported. Now that brings us a little bit also into the IHE. IHE means integrating the healthcare enterprise. The IHE defines profiles. And profiles are a set of transactions between actors, we call them. An example of an actor might be an image acquisition device, might be an image manager, database, an image archive, could be a scheduler, a modality workflow provider. So the transactions between the actors are defined in a certain sequence. So let's take a good example of an IHE profile called the Scheduled Workflow Profile, SWF, very important one. And let's look at the actor of the acquisition device. The actor of the acquisition device, if you want to be compliant with the SWF profile, it specifies that you first have to pull down a worklist, right? Get my DICOM modality worklist. And then we do the, say we start the acquisition, we do MPPS start. Modality perform procedure step start. Then we start sending the images. Then we do an MPPS stop. And then we do a storage commitment. So this sequence of transactions in that particular order, including what is some of the information in those transactions, is defined by IHE profiles. Schedule workflow is an important profile that we discussed about. We'll talk about some of the other ones a little bit later on as well. So that's what the most, yeah. Let's talk a little bit about IHE and PDI, page 142 of the study guide. So portable data for imaging, PDI is another IHE profile that deals just with CDs. Now, what does the PDI, portable data for imaging, says about CDs? Well, you have to put on the CDs, first of all, a DICOM DIR, directory. And the directory will tell you everything about the images that are stored on the CD. So it needs to have a DICOM DIR, and in addition, it needs to make sure we have DICOM compatible or DICOM images. Now, we call them also DICOM Part 10 files. Why do we call them DICOM Part 10 files? Because the Part 10 of the DICOM standard tells you exactly the encoding or the encapsulation, so to speak, of these DICOM objects. So let's say an image was sent to a PACS system, and the image would have a DICOM header, and let's say the pixel data. Then we encapsulate it with a meta file, right? And by the encapsulation with the meta file that has, for example, information about the creator of the, and the, of these images, and also what's the transfer syntax. So the meta file, together with the DICOM object, is the DICOM Part 10 file. And that is a requirement to be able to create images on CDs that are compliant with the PDI profile. And there are some other requirements, for example, that you have to never do compression when you store these images on the CDs if you want to be compliant with the general purpose profile. Now, compression brings me to the compression topic, and we actually have another section about it as well. So let me talk a little bit about compression. Compression, there are different kinds of compression. There's JPEG, traditional block-based compression. There's wavelet compression. And there's also MPEG, of course. MPEG is for video. And we usually see that only for video clips. We do endoscopy, laparoscopy, some of the endoscopes. Maybe have an Olympus system or something. So that will be the MPEG encoding. But otherwise, basically we use the two different compression will be JPEG, traditional JPEG, or the new JPEG 2000, which is also wavelet. And the two different compression schemes, JPEG block-based, JPEG 2000 wavelet is a hierarchical compression scheme, very suitable for streaming. And so it actually can be perceived as a little bit better also, because instead of having the blocking artifacts, you have some rise artifacts, we call them. And also it allows you to display the images, even although the data is not totally, completely transferred to the workstation. With JPEG, traditional JPEG, you first need to download the whole image before you can display it. With wavelet, you don't have to. So that's the something about the compression. Now, setting up a connection, let's say you have a new modality that wants to connect to the PACS, requires some of the configuration parameters. And what are typical configuration parameters? I mentioned before, protocol data unit, PDU size, but also AE title. Very important to keep that unique. Application entity title, 16 bytes, and basically what you need to make sure, so 16 characters, it's case sensitive. In addition, configuration parameters will be port number, and highly recommend to use the DICOM standard port number 11112. Instead of the 104, which is also used a lot, but it could potentially give some issues. And then, of course, the IP address. So configuration parameters, AE title, IP address, port number. Then, transfer syntaxes, I'm just flipping through the study guide I know we talked about. We need to talk a little bit about AAPM, American Association for Physicists and System Medicine. So AAPM had a big document several years ago that they published that talks about calibration of monitors. And the good news is that they also published a test pattern. It's called the AAPM TG18, Test Group 18, QC pattern. So everybody should have the AAPM TG18 QC test pattern on their viewing station, because it allows you to look in one eye, you know, immediately based on that test pattern whether the system is calibrated or not, or whether some of the grayscale values are totally off. There's quite a lot of little blocks that are identified and part of this test pattern, and also text called image quality. Now, so you need to remember AAPM TG18 test pattern using for verification of for calibration of the monitors, and to make sure that it's compliant with the grayscale standard display function, GSDF. Some people call it the Barton or the DICOM curve. If you want to learn more about how to use this particular test pattern, there's actually a video, did an interview with an image quality expert you can find on YouTube on the OTECH channel. I think we went pretty much for most of the DICOM stuff. A little bit about coding. There's a couple of coding systems and terms you need to be familiar with. First of all, CPT codes. You're probably familiar with that. CPT codes, standard procedure codes, that are used for defining all the procedures that have to be performed. CPT. Then we have the ICD-9 codes, which is or in the future ICD-10, which gives you the diagnosis and what the providers are looking for many cases that there's a match between procedure and diagnosis. For example, if the procedure would be MRI of the left knee and the diagnosis would be headaches or right shoulder dislocation, of course, there's no match. So ICD-9 or ICD-10, CPT, different coding systems. And very important also, we need to know about SNOMED CT. So SNOMED is a coding system that is used extensively in the DICOM world, because a lot of information in the DICOM header is encoded in SNOMED. For example, instead of a body part, such as a chest, it gives you a coat. Or such as a breast, it gives you a coat. Or such as an extremity. So know that SNOMED are codes used for body parts, viewing codes, and other things to be used in the DICOM header. Yeah, I'm not going to go in too much details about the different IHC profiles. This case, there's a good list and about the different profiles you'll probably be asked about. It's on page 277. I would definitely review that. I talked a little bit about earlier about scheduled workflow. You need to know about it. Then you probably need to know about key images, KIN profile that supports the key images, and PDI. Portable data for imaging profile. Of course, I need to talk a little bit about the accession number. There was a question that came up. So let me back up a little bit and give you a particular scenario. Imagine a patient comes in the ER, and the physician might have an EMR, an electronic medical record, and the EMR might have the capability to place an order. We call it an order placer. And actually, the order is identified with an order placer number. If you actually would look at the HL7 transaction, that gives you an order placer number. So the order placer, the order is placed to an order filler, which might be a scheduler, for example, radiology information system. So as soon as the physician places the order on the EMR, the transaction goes using HL7 to a scheduler, and so the order is filled. There's another order filler number assigned. And the order filler number in many cases is actually the equivalent of the accession number. The accession number is also in many cases barcoded. And so if you're still in the paper world and you have a paper acquisition, on the bottom is a barcode, and that is the accession number, a unique identifier of the requisition that is tied later back to the report. So the voice recognition system or the reporting system also uses the accession number as a unique key. So accession number in the modality worklist information model, we also find the accession number back, and that's actually then equivalent or referred to what we call image service request, ISR, image service request. So an image service request, an accession number, is identified by an accession number, and it could have multiple requested procedures. For example, let's take an complicated combo study, PET CT, for example. So if you schedule a PET CT, it would have a place order number, filler order number, accession number, and it would be then two studies, a PET and a CT study, each identified with its own study instance UID. Study instance UID for the PET and study instance UID, separate one for the CT, all part of the DICOM worklist. So remember that where the accession number is, where the study is on the what level that is as well. I think this is kind of the very, very quick overview of some of the key terms regarding DICOM and regarding IHE that you probably need to know, and they're a little bit tricky to comprehend. So hopefully this helped you a little bit in some of the of understanding a little bit better some of the issues. You can read up more about it in books, the textbook, DICOM book, and also in the study guide, the CIIP study guide. If nothing else, if you have any other questions, always enjoy seeing those, so don't hesitate to send me any questions, particularly when it gets closer to the exam. And I wish you all the best luck with your exam. I hope you make it and get CIIP certified. It's a very good thing to have. Enjoy.